I say what I wanna say when I feel and I look in the mirror and know I'm there.
Hello? Hey man, what up? Nah man, I'm off that. Huh? I'm gonna run that back. A word? Hold up. About to peep that joint. Yo, your homegirl stay posting Trump tweets. She bugging. Who, me? Nah, doc. She by her own self. She ain't about to have me looking crazy out in these streets. My bad. Hey, man, but look, I'm about to holler at you later, man. I'm finna do this video real quick. Alright, doc. Peace. This subject right here is near and dear to my heart. Some call it black dialect, black English, African-American vernacular English. Author Lisa J. Green refers to it as African-American English in her book, African-American English, A Linguistic Introduction. Now, for those of you who aren't familiar with African-American English, it can be defined as an English dialect that has its own system of grammatical rules, semantics, and an ever-growing lexicon that are spoken primarily by African-Americans. So in this video, I'll start by talking about the origin of African-American English. I'll talk about a few features of the vernacular, and I'll conclude by mentioning some of my experiences of being an African-American English speaker. Now, although I can't give an extensive analysis of the geographical, historical, and racial components that make up African-American English, I will ultimately shed light on the power and richness of this vernacular. And plus, this will be number one with regards to the short series that I'll do on language. The origin. Where did African-American English start? And who exactly were the first users of African-American English? Now, according to Green, it's pretty hard to pinpoint the exact coordinates of where the language derived. Because there are a large amount of language users who share the same vernacular, speech patterns that change over time, the fact that language itself evolves over time, and research that must be taken into account from non-standard English speakers over the course of decades. She goes on to mention that there's controversy surrounding the idea that African-American English started as a Creole, which is a language that is formed by means of communicating with other speakers that don't share the same language as you do. This Creole that she's referring to is spoken in the Sea Islands off the coast of South Carolina and Georgia. There is also the historical component of slavery that must be taken into account simply because this is the result of the African diaspora within the U.S. context. Green mentions that after the Emancipation Proclamation, narratives were recorded from ex-slaves in the mid-19th century. And so the origin debate continues. But what is interesting is that researchers' findings and hypotheses are often based on the lexicon and features that are used within the African-American community. Which brings me to my next point, African-American English features. Now, one of the most prominent features of African-American English is the zero copula. This basically happens when the auxiliary verb is omitted in language. For example, you got a little girl at the house, she hears a phone ring, she picks up, the caller asks for her mom, and the little girl goes, "Oh, she working." Another feature would be the lexicon and meaning of those words within the lexicon. Now, rather focusing on individual words and the meanings that African Americans have given them, I'd rather focus on how the semantics within African American English came about. And I love how the reference author Smitherlin recognized the factor that language and meaning is formed through shared experiences. In his book Black Talk, he says that Black talk takes us across boundaries. Regardless of job or social position, most African Americans experience some degree of participation in the life of the community. This creates in-group crossover lingo that is understood and shared by various social groups within the race. Based on your experiences as an African American, trust me, there will be words and phrases that arise spontaneously as a result of those experiences. Now, in my experiences, I associate my vernacular with black spaces. By black spaces, I mean places where the vernacular can be spoken and flourish. My home in Virginia, my church home, and basically any other space where both parties are able to engage in a healthy exchange of that vernacular. I also associate my vernacular with music. I'm reminded by songs like Redbone by Childish Gambino. All right. Kendrick Lamar.
Nigga, we gon' be alright, huh? We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
What you want? You a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar, anything. See, my name is Lucy, I'm your dog. Motherfucker, you can live at the mall.
And One More Game by D'Angelo. Music to my ears. However, because the vernacular isn't prescriptive, some may deem it as incorrect, undesirable, ghetto, or outright wrong. And there are some that might admire the way you articulate yourself, so much so that they imitate you. For example, I was helping a colleague with some resources and she made a light remark about how I should add a few more gestures to the way I speak or otherwise it'll lose its spunk. Now, although I didn't agree with what she said, she followed up with this question, is what I'm doing racist? Now, at that point, I had so much going through my mind that I didn't have a chance to give her an honest response or a quick and honest reflection. Now that I thought about it a bit, let me give you a clear answer. Yes. The fact that you've equated my vernacular with a minstrel show is indeed racist. Now, another thought that ran through my mind at the time was that when it comes to my vernacular, there's a fine line between cultural appreciation and cultural appropriation, which leads me to my next point, cultural preservation. Black folk, listen up now. We have got to let these young black kids know how valuable they are in a country that would say otherwise. One of the reasons why I love the African-American English is because the means by which we communicate comes from such an authentic place. So authentic that others hear and they want to mimic it, or even worse, capitalize off of it. These days, my main concern is not getting others to understand the lexicon and features that make up African-American English, because they got books and articles for days about that topic. But what I am concerned about is that there are corporate companies that have extracted what they deem as the coolest and most popular catchphrases and terms and have claimed it as their own. Meanwhile, most of these young black kids don't have a clue that they have been robbed once again by those who seek to exploit their culture, not exalt it. Now, this is my opinion because I do realize that not every African American speaks the African American vernacular English. But for those who do, hold on to it like your life depends on it. Own it, protect it, get it copywritten. No, seriously, what else do inventors do after something's been created? Look, mass production is inevitable when it comes to English language use. I just want the rest of the world to know where this authenticity came from. This has been the Black Curriculum.
All right, that's all I want to tell you. Just make sure you call us back when you get this message. Here go your mama.